The Acoustic Cafe, featuring folk and acoustic musicians from around the country, and with your host, Brad Paul. Today, we're at Passim, the legendary coffee house in Harvard Square, Cambridge, Massachusetts, and today we're featuring the music of Jeffrey Carey Sather. Now, from the spring of 1991 in Harvard Square, here is Jeffrey Carey Sather.
Chandelier and lottery ticket wallpaper in every room. With a Jack Nicholson eyebrow, he turns and inquires, would you love me if I were someone else? Would you love me if I were me? Does 50 on the highway, which drives people crazy. But he's watching the sunset in his side view mirror. He turns around every once in a while to see if it's real. While in his mind he plays in a samba bluegrass band. He plays in a country reggae band. And he sings, you may think this is me, an empty house, an empty heart, and MTV. But ooh, you gotta listen to me. My other car is a boat, and my other house is a home. My other house is a home. Gets the willies when it's dark outside, so he keeps the nightlight on the pink flamingo in his yard. And when he's surprised, he exclaims, Jesus in a prom dress. To quote his dear old daddy, he just loves to quote his dear old dead daddy. And he sings, you may think this is me, an empty house, an empty heart, and MTV. Ooh, you gotta listen to me. My other car is a boat. My other house is a home. My other house is a home. I really hope my other house is home.
Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Brad Paul, welcoming you to the Acoustic Cafe, a program where we bring you the best in contemporary singer-songwriters. Today we're coming to you from Club Passim in Harvard Square, and my guest is Jeffrey Carey Sather. How are you doing, Jeffrey?
Great.
Thanks for coming by and taking some time out to talk with us about your performance and about your career in general.
Well, thank you. My pleasure.
I understand for a while you were performing with Jonathan Edwards as part of his band, and now you're off on your own performing as a solo artist. Tell us a little bit about the difference between being in the band and being out there as a front man on your own.
Okay. Well, that Jonathan Edwards connection was almost 10 years ago now. Mm-hmm. I was playing bass in the Stockwell Brothers band, which is based up in Brattleboro, Vermont, which is where I'm from. And so we had the opportunity of both being his warm-up band and his backup band. So that was a great experience for us because we were able to play the audiences that, you know, the size that he could draw. Mm-hmm. And play our own material first and then come back on with him afterwards. So that was great. But it was very much a secondary role. I was playing bass in a five-piece band, so you're already kind of back in the trenches, as we called it, you know, the rhythm section back there slugging it out. And and then he was definitely the headliner. So it was a great experience for me. I learned a lot about music, a lot about singing.
Good way to get used to being on stage in front of people, as you say, being back in the trenches, not so much responsibility on your shoulders to carry the show.
Right, it's a good way to ease into it.
Mm-hmm.
But I'd always been an acoustic guitar player. My mother, you know, knew the standard six chords and showed them to me when I was five. And so I'd always really liked dabbling in that kind of thing. And so even though I was out, you know, playing bass on stage, when I was in my room, I was playing acoustic guitar, and I always have. So after a while, I guess about 5 years of playing professionally, the Jonathan Edwards Connection was only about a one-year thing, but Stockwell Brothers Band, with me a part of it, was about a five-year venture. And after a while, I just decided it was time to move on to something else and start doing some of my own music, which was beginning to pile up, and I really had a feel that I wanted to get that stuff out there. And we did some of it in the band context, but it's really solo material, I think.
Now, I understand that you are a very accomplished acoustic guitar player as well as a singer-songwriter, and it seems to me we see more of that these days with people like Patti LaRque, and Bruce Coburn is a good example of not only being very good and accomplished songwriters, but being able to back up that songwriting themselves on guitar. Is that something that came first for you, or was the songwriting first, and then you or made the conscious decision to follow that up with the guitar playing?
I think they both evolved kind of at the same time. I mean, I was writing what I thought were pretty nice guitar pieces in my early teens, and that's when my first lyrics started coming out, too. So there wasn't really that much of a gradation between the two. I mean, I think they both came around about the same time. But to really consciously start using more of the guitar and as more of a percussion instrument, starting to use the right hand as a drum, getting some different tones out of the various parts of the guitar other than just the strings, that was very much influenced by Michael Hedges. And when I started seeing that kind of thing, it just opened up new worlds for me, because I'd also played drums when I was younger, and it was like, oh, here's someone bringing all these aspects of music together the way I'd like to. Good songwriter, good guitar player, very percussive, it moves. So yeah, that's what I've been trying to do, and it really makes it a much more enjoyable thing for me now, kind of opening up
making the guitar more of the backup band that you don't
right.
have. Right?
I can be both in the trenches with the rhythm section and up front at the same time.
Mm-hmm. Now, you grew up in Greece initially, and then
that's
moved
right.
to Brattleboro, Vermont?
That's right. I moved to Thessaloniki, Greece when I was 5 years old. My father was teaching in a school over there, and my mother then started to also. So we were there from 61 to 70. Five to age 14.
Mm-hmm.
Figure out the math. And that was a great experience. I mean, it's a wonderful country. In the early 60s, it was not a developed country at all. No TV, no running water, no electricity the first few years when we were there. So it was really nice.
Was it a bit of a culture shock coming to the States after that? And was that some of the basis for you as a songwriter to draw upon those experiences?
Very much, yeah. I don't do any of that material now because I think I've kind of grown beyond it, but it was very much a way for me to exorcise some of the angst that I had coming back and plopped down in the middle of a huge high school, you know.
Yeah.
15 homerooms for just the freshman class, you know, 25 kids in each homeroom. I was used to having 6 or 7 kids in the classroom.
Wow.
So it was pretty traumatic. Luckily, I had sports to fall back on, to kind of have as a way to get myself in with the kids you're supposed to be in with. You know, I never felt like I really had to be on the outskirts of anything. I was pretty well accepted right off the bat. played soccer that first fall, mm-hmm. you know, I'd grown up playing soccer, and so that was a nice big note for me.
Well, we look forward to seeing your performance here today.
I can't wait.
And thank you again for coming by.
Thank you, Brad.
We'll return with more from Jeffrey Carey Sather here on the Acoustic Cafe right after this.
This man is one of tens of thousands imprisoned or tortured because of the peaceful expression of their beliefs, the color of their skin, their religion, even their sex. Since 1961, Amnesty International has worked on behalf of over 42,000 such prisoners. By putting pressure on governments worldwide, Amnesty members are giving prisoners like him not just hope, but freedom. Raise your voice. Call 1-800-55-AMNESTY.
Wake up all the teachers, time to teach a new way. Maybe then they'll listen to what you have to say.
The power of teaching.
The world won't get no better if we're just...
The power to wake up young minds, the power to wake up the world. Teachers have that power. Reach for the power. Teach. I'm Edward James Olmos, and we're recruiting new teachers. Call 1-800-45-TEACH.
And now back to more music on the Acoustic Cafe, recorded in Cambridge, Massachusetts at Passim, and the music of Jeffrey Carey Sather.
Head in the clouds, my heart in hand. I sing this song to celebrate you. But I don't know your name or the color of your hair, your dreams or your games or the styles you wear. But I sing this song to celebrate you. My heart beats like this, it's a sure sign I'm thinking of you, anticipating our peace. And when my heart beats, and when my heart beats, it beats for you. For the many machinations of the thoughts within your mind, how it works, what it is you feel. I don't care about your quirks, I just want you to hear this song I sing to celebrate you. And my heart beats like this, it's a sure sign I'm thinking of you, anticipating our first kiss. And when my heart beats, and when my heart beats, it beats for you. Sure sign I'm thinking of you, anticipating our first kiss. And when my heart beats, when my heart beats,
peace for you. Here by the sea, with my head in the clouds, my heart in my hand, and I rejoice out loud, 'cause I sing this song to celebrate you. I sing this song to celebrate you. I sing this song. When my heart beats, it beats for you.
A song now that it's a composite sketch of three people that I've known, three young kids actually that I worked with, and everything in this song is true, unfortunately, and I guess I'll have to confess that I've broken one of the most cardinal rules in songwriting on this one. You know, you're always supposed to, if you're gonna have a hit on your hands, you gotta come up with a catchy title, repeat it many times in the chorus, and everyone will remember it. I'll buy the tape on the way out. Boom. The title of this song shows up once. It's the very end of the song, and I just hope that no one's very offended by that. I hope that's okay. It's called Manchild. Young man up in Portsmouth. His car was broken down by the road. He asked me for a ride to his job site, where there were trucks waiting for him to unload. And I wondered about his history, and I wondered about his life, wondered about his anxiety and why he felt the need to carry a knife. On the way into town, we got talking about the lives we had both come to lead. Family, he became quite distraught. He bent over and his nose began to bleed. He sobbed and protected his neck. He began to tell me of his pain and his hurt. He did not care that I saw him struggle, or that the blood was staining his shirt. And I wondered about his history, and I wondered about his life, and I wondered about his anxiety and what it meant for his innocent wife. About meeting his father, My friend was 10 when they first shook hands by the fireplace. And talking about the joy that he knew for those 2 weeks. Until the man shot himself in the face. He said, I know that the war was a bad one. After which my father was never the same. But I can't stop having that feeling that I am the one to be blamed. He's an angry man child. He's an angry man child. He's an angry man child. Thank you. Off in the distance, on the face of the rising full moon, and I see you on the broad side of the mountain with the Indian paintbrush in bloom. I think I see you on the banks of the river. You step lightly, then lift off your summer dress, and as you wade out into the current, I send you home this SOS. I'm thinking, why must it always be that I see you most clearly when we're the farthest apart? And what will it take besides an act of God to get you into or out of my heart? It's kind of an ambivalent love song. I look into the twilight at Mount Rushmore. I see George, then I see you, and as I shake my head at the illusion, I'm wondering, must this confusion be true? Why must it always be that I see you most clearly when we're the farthest apart? And what will it take besides an act of God to get you into just a bit bizarre. Good God, I cannot believe this. There you are, hitchhiking up ahead. Should I stop and bring you home forever, or pretend not to see you instead? why must it always be that I see you most clearly? When will it be farthest apart? What will it take besides an act of God to get you into or out of my heart? I see you off on the horizon, on the face of the rising full moon. And I see you on the broad side of the mountain with the Indian paintbrush in bloom. Thank you very much. TV, ooh, you gotta listen to me. My other car is a boat. My other house is a home. Mm-hmm. My other house is a home. I really hope my other house is a home.